barely made it in time. Hi everyone, I'm Hussein Abbas. I'm here to talk about static analysis and how you would use it in your Drupal code. So thank you for coming. I barely made it here. I'm sorry, I'm a little late, but I think we are all good starting up. Just give me a minute here. So it's post-lunch, and you know, the session gods have decided that I always have to get a post-lunch session. And well, I'm up for the challenge. Let's see if they're right today. So let me introduce myself. I'm Hussein Abbas, like I've said once already. I work at Accelerant as an engineering manager, and I have been involved in the community since a few years now, and I met a lot of amazing people, learned a lot of awesome stuff. And I hope you learned something useful here today. You can find me later at Accelerant's booth. I think it's booth 603 or 613, I'm forgetting a little bit, in the exhibit hall. I commonly go on Twitter as Hussein Webb, so if you feel that you have to make fun of me on Twitter, do it properly, mention me. So yeah, let's talk about static analysis. And you know, contrary to what the image says, we're not going to analyze that image. So let's look at a few code examples to understand what it means. Can anyone tell me, can anyone notice anything wrong with this code sample? Yes. Yeah, essentially, yes. What about this one?
Translation.
The translation, you're right, yeah. Okay, so a Drupal 8 example now. What do you think? I'm sorry? Yes, exactly, yeah. Is it really fast? What about this? Any ideas? I'm sorry? Yes. This? An easy one. Yes, you're right, yeah. The title key is defined again. What about this? Sure, yeah, that's one thing, yeah.
Doesn't return anything.
I'm sorry, who said that the passing by reference thing? So, you know, you're passing by reference, so, and yeah, I think, well, now I'm confused, you know. Should this return or not? Well, yeah, like, this is the general feeling you get. You know, there are so many, even in this, so, well, actually, you know, you guys defeated me over here. I was thinking that we would take more time on that. But these were all simple examples. And, you know, when it comes to actual code, huge diffs, that the kind of code that you review usually in your pull requests, and you know, especially in code reviews, when you need to get something merged quickly, it's difficult to keep track of what's wrong, what could go wrong, you know, things like these, all of those different things that we discussed just now, this and more. You know, there are many more kinds of logical errors in code that we need to catch. Things could slip by, and so we shouldn't be doing this at all. You know, we should let the computer do this. So, before we go on, you know, before we start talking about various tools and, you know, how do we actually do this with a computer, let's broadly classify the various kinds of issues that we usually see in code. Code style issues is one of them, and you know, I consider this is one of the more important ones. If you are, even if a team of two people, you would have to work harmoniously together. And code styles are one of the ways to do that. There are variety of code format, code formatting guidelines. You know, I mean, I don't really care which one you use as long as you use one of them consistently. When it comes to Drupal, you know, if you're building a Drupal site, if you're writing Drupal modules, you know, just make it simple and use the Drupal code formatting style. That would be my suggestion. Then there are, of course, things like PSR2. Each framework has their own, I think Zend has its own formatting guideline. Symfony just uses PSR2, I think. It's completely up to you, but as long as you're consistent, you're fine. And I would definitely count this as an issue. If a piece of code is not following a particular formatting guideline, it's going to create confusion later on, because somebody's going to maintain that code. That somebody could be you. Then there are logical issues with the code. Some of the issues could be directly associated with the code. Like the issues that we saw, just now, a few examples. And some of them could, have to do with the business logic of, what your code is doing. And those are, of course, those are not our forte here. We'll talk about it. Finally, we have runtime issues, things like your database server going away, or the API that you rely on that goes away. Those kind of runtime issues. So, it's not a strict classification, but very broadly, for purposes of our discussion today, let's say that these are the kind of issues. And for the style issues and the code formatting issues, you would just use static analysis. In code reviews, you should not really spend your time debating, whether the formatting is correct or not. Just let the tool do its job. And logical issues related to code. Like we saw again, all the examples that we saw, all the six examples, all of them can be caught by code. Can be caught by those tools. And the other issues, the logical issues related to domain. Does the code fulfill your business objective? Or runtime issues, Now these are the domain of, these are the forte of automated testing. And this is really out of the scope for today's talk. There are other talks related to automated testing. And, it doesn't make it any less important. In my opinion, both of them are equally important. Usually, the issues covered by static analysis and automated testing, they form a Venn diagram, something like this. And, you would notice that there is a kind of an overlap, which is fine, I guess. I don't get very pedantic about it. It's fine if there's an overlap. But ideally, you would aim to reduce the overlap. And the reason is simple. You could say that the number of bugs in your code is directly proportional to the number of lines of code you write. Anyone writes, not you write. Anyone writes, there is always a chance of more and more bugs, So just avoid the chances of bugs. Here I feel I should include the argument for, things like type hinting. I'm in favor of type hinting. I don't intend to start any flame wars here. I know they're not as passionate as Vim versus Emacs, but anyway. So type hinting, yeah. So type hinting, in my opinion, catches a lot of, first of all, it assists the tools that we're going to talk about, So it makes it, the tools can, they have more information to go on when they analyze the code. But it also improves readability to you. Can I get a quick show of hands? How many of you have still, how many of you have not worked with Drupal 8 yet? Okay. So one of the things that you will see when you start working with Drupal 8 is that, it might seem intimidating to you right now. The whole object-oriented programming, the whole object-oriented nature of code and everything, it might seem intimidating. And I agree with you. It's always difficult to learn something new. But the benefits are immense over here. You should make that journey and think about all this, the code that you write in terms of objects passing around messages. And again, I think I'm digressing a bit too much over here, but I just want to bring it back to the type hinting topic. These types, if all of your code can be represented as objects, and your business flow can flow through as communication between various objects, then there is very little you know, very little that can go wrong from the business logic point of view. You know, I mean, all of those cases can be covered by automated testing and static analysis. The objective is to, I mean, I won't stress too much on it, but the objective is to make this overlap as minimum as possible. One thing is, again, the type hinting argument from earlier. If you type hint your code, that's that many less tests you have to write. You don't have to write unit tests checking if this function works with different types of input or not. You know, if you have type hinted it and, you know, you're using PHP 7, which enforces this type hints, you know, the code won't even run. You know, like they, like the equivalent of the code won't even compile. So you can, if your code works, you can be sure it will work fine. So moving on, you know, let's talk about some of these tools. Anyone familiar with any of these tools over here? All of them? Okay, a good number, yeah. Again, you know, I have a kind of a demonstration plan, but there is not enough time to go in depth into it. My intention is to cover, you know, cover all of these tools from a very on a very very broad level. So we'll actually start with PHP Code Sniffer, and this is one of the staples. You know, we have probably used this already. I think Drupal installs it by default anyway. I could be wrong. So PHP Code Sniffer uses something called sniffs, which is basically just a collection of rules. You know, so if you define your code formatting guideline as a collection of rules, and you can do much more than that. You know, you could actually, so as we'll see, you know, PAReview can catch a lot of different kinds of errors, different kind of issues. So you can define all of this as sniffs, and just have to run PHP CS along with that sniff against your code. And there are, I'm like, you typically won't really need to write a sniff normally. There are a lot of sniffs available. Once you install PHP CS, you get a good bunch of them already, you know, things like PSR2 and PSR1 and Xen framework and all that. The Drupal sniff is available as part of Coder, the Coder module that includes the Drupal sniff. And there are two more sniffs which are available as projects on Drupal.org. So PHP CS is quite simple. You probably can't read that thing. You know, we'll see a demo, so that's fine. Then PAReview. So PAReview, it just uses PHP CS, and you know, the three sniffs I mentioned earlier, it just runs them one after another. You know, the Drupal sniff, Drupal secure, and Drupal practice, it just runs them, and it also does a few other checks which are really relevant to contributed modules. So the background is that this was written as a bot to check the quality of modules you're contributing. Do you remember, like, I think at least a year back, you would have to go through a like a vetting procedure before you can create full projects on Drupal.org. Anyone remembers that? Yeah. So this was a script that assisted in automated reviews. So, you know, as soon as you create a project application on Drupal.org, it will run this website. A bot will run your module code against this tool, and it'll give a report, you know, what's missing. So things like, it actually checks a lot more things like, you know, is the README file there? Or if you have included license.txt by mistake, things like that. Now, it's this tool, since it's like a scripted tool, you know, it runs PHP CS three times with different sniffs and everything. It's not really that easy to use it in CI. So the reason is simple, you know, it swallows the written code. So if one of the runs fails, you won't know it. You know, the CI build won't stop. So it makes it useless in CI environments, but it's still very useful if you're running it locally. You know, while you're developing, just run it. You know, it's a shortcut. There is a project page on Drupal.org which explains how do you install this Drupal.org/project/PAReview.sh. So you have to install PAReview tool, and then you have to install PHP CS, of course, because it uses PHP CS. And then you have to install these sniffs. So one of the sniffs is by Coder module, and the other two. We'll again come back to a demo for this. Then there is PHP mesh detector. It's not very commonly used, and this is typically used for projects which has which has a high degree of object-oriented code use. Typically not something that you would see in Drupal. Now, you do, but again, most of the modules are still hooks and everything, you know. So it's not really that widely used. But some of the cool features of this is it can calculate things like code complexity, you know, cyclic complexity and nth path and things like that. Anyone familiar with those terms? Okay. Few people. I think it's little out of the scope to go in depth into those, but these are just numbers that tell you how maintainable your code is. And for example, if nPath is too high, you might want to refactor your code. And if you use PHP MD, of course, these things you can't really figure out in, you can see the code, and if you want, you can do it on paper, but nobody does that. You would just use PHP MD, and let's say if cyclic complexity is too great, you don't allow commits, you know, the CI pipeline fails. Then this is one of the newer ones, PHP static analyzer, PHP stan. Anyone use PHP stan? Okay. With Drupal, okay. So now this gets a little tricky to use with Drupal. Now this does not, as far as I know, does not check for things like code complexity. But it checks a lot of other things, like are the variables of the right type? You know, is this class actually present? It checks for best practices, things like did you really mean to use an identical operator instead of equal operator, stuff like that. So best practices and all that. But because of how Drupal works, you know, particularly the module system and everything, it's not very easy to use PHP stan. You have to write a simple config file, but it's not a drop-in thing. You need to write a simple config file, which we'll see again. Okay, yeah, sorry about that. So it just needs a simple config file, and again, the benefits are the same. It just gives you an idea of the different issues that might be in your code that you're committing. Then StyleLint, it's for all the tools that we saw so far were for PHP. StyleLint does the similar job for CSS. It checks for things like are you using invalid properties? Or as a developer, as a team lead, you can say that I don't want to allow certain units in my CSS files. You can stop that from happening. Things like the specificity of selectors. You don't want to allow highly specific selectors for some reason. It's a valid thing. If you're using, for example, if you're using SmackSS, you don't want to increase the specificity beyond a certain limit. So you can let this StyleLint do all of those things. And I think something happened and I lost ESLint over here. But ESLint is something similar which checks for JavaScript. The same kind of checks, logical checks, static checks, but for JavaScript. So that's really the tools. These tools I've found that they are more than sufficient in regular Drupal work and even regular PHP work, building web applications. But I'd like to share a few tips on using before we actually see the demo. It's highly trivial to run this locally. So, for example, if you have PAReview installed, just have to write PAReview in your path and it checks for that. But it's even more convenient if you're just putting it pre-commit. And I think there are tools like BLT, which directly install this hook. So if you're using a project based on BLT, BLT automatically creates those pre-commit hooks. You can do them manually. There's no reason why you can't. So when you create a pre-commit hook, Git, before it actually does the commit, will run this tests on all the files in the code base. And if the files are not of sufficient quality, commit won't happen. And then finally, they run it in a continuous integration pipeline. So no surprise, you can always override pre-commit hooks, right? So always run it in a CI pipeline as well. And again, you don't have to, you know, there are no absolutes here. You know, like what works for you may not work for somebody else, and what works for somebody else may not work for you. As a team lead, as a developer, you have to take a conscious decision on what works for you. So one thing, you know, like on a more theoretical note, with static analysis, the chances of false negative are virtually inexistent. You don't have false negatives, but you will have false positives. It's quite common. So by false positives, I mean that the code is actually correct. It follows the coding standard. But for some reason, for some trivial reason, one of these tools will flag it as an error. And there are different things, you know, like you can ignore a particular line or you can ignore a particular class, but you really don't want to go there. And again, you may decide that this tool by default considers as an issue, it is fine for you. It works for you. So feel free to, adapt these configuration files. For things like code formatting, I don't really see a reason why you would. But that's completely up to you. I can't imagine a reason why you would override a code formatting. But things like, type checks, for example, you can, there could be a lot of false positives over here. The way you work might just bring up a lot of false positives. So feel free to customize them. All the tools I mentioned, they are highly customizable. I mean, it takes a little bit of effort, but the benefits pay off in the long term. And, you may say that the project is small and, it's not worth it. Yeah, you may be right on that. But you can always use it for the next project. It's a little initial investment. It's the same thing as automated testing. You know, you invest a little now and you reap the benefits, practically forever. So, how do I? I'm just trying to get my screen up. Maybe mirror it. Okay. Okay, so we'll just see a couple of tools. I know that we are a little behind on time, but very quickly. What the output looks like. So this is, I didn't really find a Drupal project I could use in a demo over here. So I'm just going to use one of my PHP components. Okay. Good enough? Yeah. Okay, so this is a PHP component I wrote sometime called Date Converter, and So all I'm going to do is PHP CS, you can install it as a composer dependency, so which puts it in vendor/bin for me. If you have any doubts on installation, you can always reach out to me on Twitter. But it's fairly simple. You just have to search for PHP CS. It's fairly straightforward. And this is how you use it. Drupal standard is, I'm not sure if it's installed. Yeah, it's not installed. I'm just going to use something like PSR2. So anyway, this is, like I said, this is a PHP component. I'm not following Drupal coding standards over here. I follow PSR2 and I run it. Oh, it's taking a long time. Oh, oops, yeah, that's my fault. And give the name of the directory of your code. And nothing happens, which means that your code is fine. So this is what all the tools that are meant for a CI pipeline. This is what they look like. If there is no output, it means things are good. But just to show how it would look if it was not working. So I'm just going to use a different standard like Xen, and the code is not, of course, does not follow Xen framework standards, and I would get a list of these errors, and if I look at the status code, it's one, which means it would stop the CI build pipeline. I realize that some of you might not really understand the CI pipeline reference, and you know there are sessions after this that will probably explain it better to you. I mean, I think I'll just stick to the static analysis, and you know, hopefully by the end of this, you know, you will get a complete picture. So PHP CSS is straightforward. You know, it gives you the file name, the line number, and you know if it's an error or a warning. Warning is you know that it'll not give that error code of one. It basically it'll let the CI pipeline go, but it'll still show this warning. And others are like they are errors. You know, you have to fix them before you can go further. PHPMD. Okay, this is how you use PHPMD. You pass in the directory of your code and the output, the format of output. So you can output it in XML format if you want. You know, if in a CI pipeline you want to read the XML later on, you can do that. But we'll just use text over here. And you know, just for demo, I'm showing all these different. So these are rules. There is a rule called clean code and code size and design and use. So all of these. And if I run it, you know, it shows that these are various rules. Now, like I was saying earlier, that all of this may not really apply to you. So be judicious in applying that. You know, this may not really be applicable to you. It's fine. If you find that you know you don't want to use all of these, just remove. So for example, I don't really need the controversial rule set. So you know, I've removed that from my check. So I don't use them, by the way. This project is continuously tested in Travis, and I don't use that. I think I'm very close to end of time. But there is another project I would like to mention before going, and just few next steps. These are a few sessions that are going to follow, you know, which talk about continuous integration, and one of them is right after me, and you know, I guess you know he's probably waiting for me to get off the stage. The benefits of continuous integration, you know, he'll talk about continuous integration in depth. Today evening there is a session on automation at 5 p.m. and the other two sessions are tomorrow, one at 10:45 and the other one is at 2:15. I don't remember the room numbers. You can always find them on schedule. And these are a few links, but I think Google is your friend over here. You can find all of these links over there. And I'm done. Please join us for contribution sprints on Friday. If you have not contributed before, that's completely fine. There is a mentored course sprint. There is a first-time sprinter workshop. This will get you going. And I hear there are a lot of tools that will make it even easier for you. And yeah, please do.